So we will discuss the laparoscopic ovarian diseases. In this presentation, we will discuss the various laparoscopic ovarian pathology, how to treat. ठीक है अब तो अंत में ही होगा ना ठीक सो वील डिस्कस द लैप्रोस्कोपिक ओवरियन डिजीजेस ओवरियन सिस्ट आर सैक फिल्ड विद द फ्लूड और सेमी सॉलिड मटेरियल आइदर विद इन और ओवर द सरफेस ऑफ ओवरी सर्जरी इज इंडिकेटेड इफ इट इज more than 10 centimeter, if it is complex, if it is growing, if it is persistent, if it is solid, if it is irregular, or if it is bilateral or symptomatic. This 10 centimeter, some of the book they describe 5 or 6 also. This you have to decide which one to operate. Anatomy. Already we know that around the ovary there are three important ligaments. One is proper ovarian ligament, another is infundibular ovarian ligament, and third is infundibular pelvic ligament. It has two mesentery also, that is one is mesosalpinx, another is mesovarian. Anterior peritoneum of the mesosalpinx continue as the broad leaf, anterior leaf of the broad ligament. This is all. And posterior peritoneum of the mesovarian continue as retroperitoneum. And it is separating the ureter, resting fimbria almost sit over the ureter, and which is separated from peritoneum. Two blood supply, one is ascending uterine. Ascending uterine, once it come at the level of proper ovarian ligament, it gives three branches. One branch go to uterus, another branch go to mesosalpinx, third branch go to mesovarian. Exactly same way, ovarian artery, which is a direct branch of aorta, come in infundibulopelvic. It gives one branch in mesovarian, another branch mesosalpinx. That's why I have discussed during tubal surgery that laparoscopically few millimeter of the tube should must be coagulated and then cut. You should avoid going very near to the uterus, because if you are very near to uterus, two specific complications can happen. What are those complications? Yes, first is devascularization. That is very common in laparoscopy because of collateral damage, using bipolar collateral damage. And second complication is uteroperitoneal fistula. So this is how to avoid that few millimeters should be left attached with the uterus, and that is important. Before doing any ovarian surgery, it is a good practice to rule out the cancer, CA125, LH, FSH, estradiol, or any tumor marker, alpha fetoprotein, or anything comes in your mind, even PET scan, MRI, CT scan, if you want, you should do it, because if there is a malignancy, then it is an absolute contraindication of doing ovarian cystectomy. You can do oophorectomy. But because in laparoscopy we can never perform ovarian cystectomy without spillage. Spilling will be there. And if you spill it, there may be contamination. Although if you see the literature, you have a variable reports. What the literature say that borderline mitotic type 1 or borderline mucinous cyst adenoma is allowed to perform laparoscopy after rupturing, you only need to do the copious lavage. Even dermoid cyst, if you put in the Google dermoid rupture laparoscopy ovarian, then all the articles they show say that it is useless fear of chemical peritonitis, due to rupture of dermoid. You can do it, and after that you can do copious lavage. Copious lavage means 12 liter saline, 3 liter 4 times. How to do copious lavage? I will demonstrate you. No, this is why I told you, this may be their individual choice. It may be their individual opinion, but it is not supported by any evidence. If you will type the dermoid and rupture, ovarian cyst, rupture and copious lavage, then you will get the literature. Even if the chemical peritonitis is also done, then also it can be easily. See, this your main thing is, it is main, your concern is written here. This is same concern, it is written that greater risk of a spillage, and that was the case which was inhibiting the people to perform. But conclusion, as demonstrated, early recognition and prompt treatment by repeat laparoscopic surgery and removal of the remnant of the dermoid cyst is also possible. And peritoneal lavage, successful treatment of chemical peritonitis you can do. If you will go further, then copious lavage, intraperitoneal spillage and copious lavage is recommended. Do you know rupture of dermoid cyst and spillage is one of the big problem, but what you need? Copious irrigation. It is any surgery of the ovarian cyst, if it is endometrioma or if it is mucinous carcinoma or if it is dermoid, you cannot promise to do it without a spillage. And this fear was there, but that fear is cyst leakage. For ovarian teratoma also, but only thing is copious lavage. Copious lavage is such a beautiful thing which in open surgery can never ever be done. Open surgery is a more dirty surgery and more blind surgery. Copious lavage, I will show you how to do. So if you are adequately trained to do copious lavage, absolutely no issue. So, and none of the articles say, you cannot show me a single article published anywhere which stops you to do laparoscopy for dermoid or for endometrioma or for borderline mucinous carcinoma. It is not stopping you to do. So, but only thing is, you have to be careful. So it may be the individual opinion of that gynecologist. So selection of cases is important. Now, if you are performing the procedure and if you feel that cauliflower-like growth is there, even over the surface of the ovary or during the separation of the cyst, if you feel it inside also the surface of the ovary, you should immediately do the oophorectomy or conversion, because spillage can happen. So it is better to do oophorectomy, not to do ovarian cystectomy. Operating room setup, you will stand patient opposite to the cyst, head should be 30 degrees down. If you have a two monitor, one this side, one that side, if one monitor in between the leg as usual, one assistant need to sit in between the leg for uterine manipulation. Operating room setup, you will do the access depending upon the various needle or open technique, whatever you want. Port position, normally contralateral port you can put one in umbilicus, two 7.5 centimeter lateral and below either side. If the cyst is big, then you may use supraumbilical. Supraumbilical ports are equally good. And you have to go on one side and you will operate it like that. One of the very simple surgery which we will see first is ovarian drilling. Ovarian drilling, just you can do by the simple striker mini alligator, and you hold the ovarian ligament. Then you will go with the tritome and you will do the principle of four. Four poles should be punctured, 40 watt current should be used, and only 4 millimeter deeper it should go. It should not go more than that. You can support it also other side with the open jaw of a striker mini alligator, and then you can puncture. So 4 ports should be punctured and only 40 watt current you will use, and here it is done. Now sometime you need oophorectomy. Oophorectomy, this is a 52-year-old woman with a large ovarian cyst. Remember, any ovarian cyst which is less than 10 centimeters nearer the umbilicus, suppose this is umbilicus and cyst is up to here and it is less than 10 centimeters, you are not supposed to go to the umbilicus. You need to go to the Palmer's point. This is called as Palmer's point. Palmer point is the most attractive site whenever umbilicus is diseased. So this was a large ovarian cyst in which it is nearer to the umbilicus. So the entry is with the Palmer's. This is the vision is with the Palmer's. So this is, the patient is already 52 years, so there is no point doing the ovarian cystectomy. So this is oophorectomy which is planned. And here we can see that this is the ovary, and here this is, what is this by the way? What is this? This is deep ring. You know, that's why I told you that interpretation of anatomy and a snapshot. So if you are seeing, you should not see the ovarian cyst. You should see the snapshot. This is deep ring. Here is the inferior epigastric vessel. Do you know? And this is round ligament. In laparoscopy, the heart of the laparoscopy is laparoscopic anatomy. Unfortunately, laparoscopic anatomy is very poorly, it is not at all read in the your MBBS and your MS classes. It is completely different. So this is the deep ring. This is inferior epigastric vessel. And as soon as you see, why it is looking like that? Because your vision is from Palmer's. Now first thing what you have to do is aspiration. So you can go with the aspiration needle and you will puncture and aspirate. Initial aspiration 5 ml you can keep into a syringe, and that syringe you can bend the needle, cap it and send for cytology. And the fluid, if it comes, is clear, watery, then you can use a suction and you can keep on sucking it. So now this incision was a little bit enlarged. Here this incision is a little bit enlarged. Like that. And after that this is suction sucking it. And you're sucking. Can you see now round ligament is getting apparent now? And do you know what is this? This is medial. Medial umbilical ligament. This is median. This is median and this is medial of other side. You got it? Here. So this is why I told you the compass of the pelvis. Once you learn, then automatically it will orient you. Your orientation will be maintained and you know that where are you going. So one of the pocket of this cyst was sucked out. And that's all. You don't need to do anything else. That much is sufficient. You don't need to rupture each and every pocket. Once it is sucked, after that you can take a striker mini alligator or other grasper and you can lift the infundibulopelvic ligament. So this is over, this is the little bit spillage will happen all around. This is striker mini alligator, and now this tip of the striker mini alligator you can hold the infundibulopelvic ligament. This is infundibulopelvic ligament. And then what traction you will go? Anteromedial. Anteromedial, and then with you can go as nearer as possible to the ovary. And with the harmonic or ligature, salpingo oophorectomy is hardly 5 minute work. It doesn't take more than 5 minutes and it is getting cut. This is tube, this is ovary, this is IP ligament. Ureter will be somewhere below. So as soon as you give anteromedial traction, you will be away from triangle of doom and you will go away from ureter, and then salpingo oophorectomy can easily be performed. So this is done. Now IP ligament is cut. Now this is little bit meso-ovarian, little bit meso-ovarian, and it is meso-ovarian is also done. Now you can, this is, you can relocate it, this is uterus, and this is proper ovarian ligament. Now the striker mini alligator can leave and it can reattach to the proper ovarian ligament. So it is reattaching the proper ovarian ligament. And again enteromedial, and this is this instrument, as you can see, it is coming percutaneously. It doesn't need, so basically it's a two-port surgery. And then you can bring the harmonic and you can cut it near the ovary. And this is the ovarian ligament. And it is done. Now the question is how to remove it. Removal is one challenge because large cysts, large sizes, endobags are generally not available. So in those situations, colpotomy is the best route to remove this. And you will lift the uterus antiverted. This is the other ovary is normal, as we can see here. This ovary is normal and uterus will be lifted up. And once uterus is lifted, then here this is the, you will take a sponge of a size of a table tennis ball and you will push it into the posterior fornix like this. This is a table tennis ball, and do you know this is uterosacral ligament here. Can you see that? This is uterosacral. And you have to go 1, 2, 3 centimeters below the arc of uterosacral and cut it. Here we can see our camera person is unfortunately rotating the little CCD. So little looking like that, this is wrong. Actually this should be at 12 o'clock position. So anyway, if he is doing wrong, you should cut it oblique. If you cut like that, it will be wrong. So now, and it is, it should be cut. This is the rectum, terminal part of the anus, and here is the rectum. So you should must be careful that you should be on the shiny fascia, vaginal fascia. Shiny fascia, and once, as long as levator ani muscle of the patient is healthy, you will never get rectum over your sponge. Only vagina can be brought, posterior fornix, vaginal fascia can be brought. And then either with the harmonic or with the hook, you can do colpotomy. Colpotomy is done in many cases. You can do colpotomy in TLH, colpotomy in NDVH, colpotomy in the tissue retrieval, but it varies. There are different ways of doing colpotomy in various situations. When you do colpotomy in TLH, we do from a top here. We never include the vaginal part. This is vaginal part of the uterosacral, isn't it? We go to cervical part. We never touch this part because we don't want wall prolapse. But in this tissue retrieval, it should be 1, 2, and 3 centimeters below, so that you can stretch it up to 6 centimeters, and it should reach up to the uterosacral ligament. It should never cross the uterosacral ligament. If you cross the uterosacral ligament, there will be a big problem. There will be a big problem. So slowly you can cut it like that. And here it is. It is reached there. This is the sponge of a size of a table tennis. After that you will pull it. And then you will put a claw forceps and hold the claw forceps by the side of this sponge. A sponge will not be removed out of the vagina because it will prevent the gas leak. And after that you can hold it and you will bring in the vagina. Once it comes in the vagina, then you have to apply 2 speculum, one above, another below. And with the scissors you need to bisect it. And then with the finger you will break the septa. So it will drain in the vagina. It will drain in the vagina, and what you can do in your part, that you can rupture it, especially if you are sure that this is simple cyst. So it is puncturing. So a couple of places you will puncture, and slowly, it doesn't matter how much big is there, you can take it out. And if, pardon? Morcellator unfortunately doesn't work for ovarian cyst. Remember, morcellator works for heart tissue, like uterus or fibroid. You know, soft tissue like bowel or the cyst, you cannot, mortality will stop because the blade doesn't cut. Like suppose you have a grinding machine or a drill machine, you can drill a wall, you can drill a wood. But if you try to drill a cloth, it will wrap around and it will stop. So, and this will be the colpotomy wound is the best wound because it will do the very good outlet also, all the irrigation suction also come out, spill free, because it's a dependent area. Just like the stopper of the washing room, washing machine. As soon as washing is complete, you drain it and all the drop of water will come out. You know, we have a lot of experience of doing the huge ovarian cyst. These type of 30 centimeters, we have done up to 35 centimeter ovarian cyst by laparoscopy. How to do? I will show you. This is a patient who has the huge ovarian cyst and it was a mucinous cyst adenoma. Known case of mucinous cyst adenoma. And you can see it is without pneumoperitoneum. This is the abdomen. And this was complete a full term pregnancy. So now you can take directly on the umbilicus, you can inject the syringe and you can suck some of the fluid out. This is just to make it sure that it is the cyst and there is nothing anterior to the cyst. After this 5 millimeter trocar will directly puncture the cyst. It is puncture the cyst. And then you can put the suction and you can suck it. 7 liter of the fluid came out from this suction. You can see it is sucking the fluid from the cyst directly. Directly you will suck it. And after that abdomen will become relaxed. And now we are inside. You can see this cyst is almost occupying all the quadrant of the abdomen. Upper abdomen, right hypochondrium, left hypochondrium. And after aspiration, you have a beautiful space in this cyst. Reason being that it was already keeping the abdominal wall stretched. So once cyst is collapsed, you have beautiful space to work. By the way, this is the median umbilical ligament, this is the medial umbilical ligament, this is the lateral umbilical ligament. This is again medial umbilical ligament and this is lateral umbilical ligament. And here is the, this is the area of bladder. In between, this is the area of bladder, as you know, in between both the medial umbilical ligament. So this patient has the mucinous cyst adenoma. Here is the inferior epigastric vessel. And what is this? Deep ring, isn't it? And what is this? Round ligament. This is the round ligament. And here is the inguinal ligament going. And here will be the Cooper. This is Cooper ligament. And here will be Lacunar. And this is median. And this is triangle of doom. This is triangle of pain. Isn't it? And this is the deep ring of this side. And this is the triangle of doom this side. So this is how the compass of the pelvis will give you the orientation. And then you can see everything. Now this is all cyst. This is infundopelvic ligament. Here is the, this is the uterus below. This is the pubic symphysis bone. And everywhere only the ovary and ovary is there. Now what you can do? You have to do the salpingo-oophorectomy. So never mind. This is uterus. This is uterus. This is triangle of doom of right side. And spilled fluid immediately. You should suck it out. Spilled fluid, you should suck it out all around. If here we can see, this is also you can suck it out. This was the opening of the trocar, 5 millimeter trocar, which has punctured it. So through the same opening, you can aspirate further. Now, directly you will go to the IP ligament. This is the median umbilical ligament. This is the median and this is medial. This is medial and this is the deep ring. This is round ligament. This is IP ligament. IP ligament. So directly you can, this is tube. This is fimbria and this is tube. And directly you can go to the IP ligament. And within 5 minutes, that much huge ovarian cyst, you can, oophorectomy you can do. So this is now directly giving the, but your port position should be correct, your basic baseball diamond concept should be there and you should know how to perform the correct access technique And now this is the IP ligament, and you can directly go with the ligature. Here there was little bleeding, so it was thought that let us take ligature, because harmonic is not a good vessel sealer. Can you see that? If you see, if you will compare, see this tissue was cut by harmonic, and you will compare the next bite is taken by the ligature, and see this is the, it is sealed. Can you see that? See the difference of this and this. So this is the difference between the vessel sealer and harmonic. So whenever you think that sealing, you need more sealing, but if it is peritoneal dissection, it will seal, it will not dissect it. So harmonic is good for peritoneal dissection because it's a dissector and it is sealed. That's why this area which was cut initially with the harmonic is sealed again. See, this is sealing, how the ligature seals and harmonic actually dissect. So this is now done, and now this is the last part. So you can do very quickly the oophorectomy, and this type of huge cyst, again you need to remove from the colpotomy. Colpotomy is the best route for the removal, and that is undoubtedly ideal for peritoneal toileting, because you can put completely 3 liter of saline, and at the end all will be drained. Here this is the vagina, this is, by the way, sacral pulmonary. Here the sacral pulmonary, here will be the anterior longitudinal ligament, and what is this? Ureter. Can you see that? This is the ureter going, and what is this? External iliac artery, and this is vein, isn't it? And this, that's why this is triangle of doom here, and this is the ureter, and this is the anatomy. This is what? Sigmoid colon, right? In sacrocolpopexy, we cut the peritoneum from here to here, just to hide the mess. And this is the vaginal part of the uterosacral ligament, and here the cervical part go. This is, in this patient, this has a dermoid cyst also. This is dermoid cyst of this side. But she wanted to preserve the ovary, so we have to do the cysticotomy here, and this side oophorectomy. So now this is the triangle of doom, this is round ligament, and this is sigmoid. So now this is colpotomy will start. There is a sponge which is pushing into the posterior fornix, and then with the hook or with this you can cut it here, and this is the colpotomy started. 1, 2, 3 centimeter below, 3 centimeter below you will cut it. This is a sponge, you can appreciate the fibers of the gauze piece, which is, this is up to uterosacral ligament, both the side, 3 centimeter in between, up to uterosacral. If you will, suppose you will cut it here, then uterosacral arc will not allow it to stretch, isn't it? And if you will cut uterosacral, then there will be prolapse. So you have to go 3 centimeter below and up to uterosacral. So generally it becomes 3 centimeter wide, but it will stretch up to 6 centimeter, and then you will cut it like that, and then this is a split, and here you will cut it. So this is done, and then you can cut it out this side. And it is cut. After that you will just rotate the sponge and screw the sponge, and then let the entire sponge come in the abdomen here. So this is opened now. This is the sponge which is inside the abdomen. Immediately gas will start leaking, so immediately take it back in the vagina, because gas is leaking. And now the, by the side of this you will put a claw forceps. And here it is, came back in the vagina. So this is ureter, by the way. And as I told you earlier, that this is the uterosacral, and this distance is 2.5 centimeter, isn't it? And at this place, ureter is not visible because it is sandwiched by the vein, which is posterior, and artery is anterior. And by the way, it has to pierce the broad ligament to go posterior to the bladder. So it will now go anterior to the broad ligament to enter into the trigone of the bladder. And this is the point where maximum injury of ureter happens in total laparoscopic hysterectomy. So, and here is the ureter going. and this is the internal iliac is here. This is internal iliac. This is internal. Although it is not relevant to this surgery, but anatomy just to get a snapshot, because if your brain knows, then I will search for that. And do you know what is this? This is medial umbilical ligament, which go up to there. This is medial umbilical ligament. Later you will see how it enters. And this is the external iliac artery, this is external iliac vein. And here is the IP ligament which is cut. So now this is the claw forceps, and this claw forceps will hold the thinnest part of the cyst, and it will come into the vagina. And once it comes into the vagina, then you have to ideally go in the vagina. Better to give the telescope to the assistant who is holding, and you go, because there may be disaster if the person is not trained, then he may do the disaster. So how to do in the vagina is important to learn. So let us go to the vaginal part now. This is the laparoscopic part is over. After that, you just keep the telescope, should always be visible. And you can puncture a couple of drill you can give on the cyst. But in spite of that, you have to drain it here. In the vagina, what you do, you hold by the two claw forceps to either side, or cockers, two cockers either side, and then you will cut in between. So this is one cocker from this side, and another cocker from that side. This is one cocker, and this is another cocker, and with the scissors, you split it in between. And after that, you put a finger, and with the finger, you will break the septas to let it drain. And then automatically it comes out, easily it comes out. And you will put a finger to break it. And here you break it, and it is now draining. You may use a suction also to suck it out. And it is slowly evacuate, right, left, up, down, right, left, up, down, you will do. And again cut it. And see, two fingers are in this pocket. Can you see this?
Yeah.
This is important. You have to open the cyst inside the vagina. And two finger is breaking. Sometimes you may pierce the suction to break the uncut septa. And then slowly it will deliver out. And it is coming. And again right, left, up, down, you will do. And entire ovary can be taken out. It doesn't matter how much big it is. If it is 35 centimeter, 45 centimeter, any size it can be. It may need time. And right, left, you have to do by zigzag fashion. Do you know, just like a football. Football has inside a rubber bladder. And opening is so small. But once it is collapsed, it can be taken out. And it is going, and this is the last part. And now it is out. Once it is out, after that your main job starts. And here it is now out. It is out. After that, main job, this is the left-sided dermoid. You can open the outer ovarian cortex and you can separate the cyst. And here it is the dermoid cyst. Of course, it should be taken. You should try your best that it should come intact. But approximately 50% of the cases in laparoscopy, it ruptures. But you should never mind, rupturing is allowed in laparoscopy. There is no issue. You should try your best, but unfortunately, laparoscopic instrument has trauma. It is impossible that it will behave like your finger. Because it doesn't matter, even if you will take an atraumatic grasper and all, little trauma is there always in laparoscopy. That's why it crushes the suture also. It breaks the tissue also. So it is trying to separate it. Yes, because robotic instrument articulates, but robotic also doesn't have tactile feedback. But the good thing about that, it articulates. So you can make a plane of dissection all around. So that is less in the robotic compared to, but in robotic also, you tactile feedback you don't have. That unfortunately is only in the open surgery. And even open also it ruptures. People they don't speak about, but it ruptures. And they don't tell anyone, but it ruptures. So as soon as it was ruptured, it go to the, even sebaceous cyst when you, general surgeons when they do, it ruptures in 50% cases, isn't it? But you take it out. So now it is ruptured, and after rupturing actually taking the cyst out will be easy, because now you can hold it and you can take it out. So now it is within few seconds it is out. It is out. And again you will push it into the vagina. Now starts your real game. What is the real game? That first thing, what you do, you take it out. This is a stone holding forceps, catching the dermoid cyst, bringing out, suck the anterior fornix and suck the posterior fornix and drain it. After that, pack the vagina with the sponge. And then complete 3 liters of the saline, you have to put in the abdomen. Who say laparoscopy cannot clean better? In open surgery, you can never clean this way. At the end of the surgery, you will see it will be so nicely glistening white color that it is impossible by any open surgery. By the way, I will show you, this is vena cava. This is vena cava and this is the CBD. And this is duodenum and this is vena cava. This is right lobe of the liver, left lobe of the liver. You have to put entire 3 liters of saline. This is, warm saline means body temperature saline. It should not be very cold, normal saline. And then irrigate, keep on irrigating. How you will know 3 liters of the saline has been introduced? You have to see the patient is flat, not head down, not head up. And you have to put and wash it just like how you are shaking the washing machine. This is left lobe of the liver, this is a spleen. And everywhere you will shake the intestine, a small bowel, everywhere. And see, it is deep ring here. This is deep ring, isn't it? And up to deep ring, if the saline reaches, that means it is an indicator of the amount in normal adult without any lesion, without any fibroid, or without any lesion, and without head down or head up in supine position. If the fluid reaches up to deep ring, that means amount is 3 liters. In the normal 3 liters of fluid, it comes. So we can see here that every drop of intestine, every piece of omentum is shaking into the saline, and you can, it is dwelling, it is swimming actually in the saline, and you can move it, you can swim it. This is the, you can have the ovary of the other side, and your tube, appendix, cecum, everything is dropped, and you will keep on shaking it. In the dermoid or in those cases, they have a fatty content, so it swims like a mud over that if it is there. And mucinous cystoderma also, it will come similarly. Sorry.
I have one question. Sometimes you don't know whether any malignancy, why use water? Because water is hyper thermic, it will light the tumor cell.
Yes, that is, some people they use the distilled water. Distilled water, simple water will not do, because distilled water you can do. But you know, it is good if you have a already radical hysterectomy, then they use distilled water. But here, if a potential risk, and there may be little increased risk of the peritonitis, because it ruptures the cell and inflammation can be increased. So in cases of known case of malignancy, it is good. But routinely, in every case, it is not recommended, because patient may have increased pain and discomfort postoperatively. So you will keep on swelling, dwelling the saline entirely. This is all mesentery is dwelling into the saline. And still irrigation is continued. It is not that irrigation is not done. Entire anterior and posterior cul-de-sac, all is dipped in the saline. Appendix is also, as you can see, it is swelling into that. And after that, once you see that it is reaching now up to deep ring here, and then what you do, tell the assistant to immediately just support the uterus and tell the assistant to remove the sponge. And after that, immediately all the fluid, huge amount, just like how during the delivery and rupture of the membrane and all the water comes, same way through the vagina, huge amount of the water will leak. And that will give, see how beautiful it is, shiny now. Absolutely no blood, no dirty dermoid content, no hair, no fluid. Even mucinous cystoderma, if it is there, it will be. And this is not one time, this is only first time going on. You have to do four times. And you cannot suck it. If you suck it, some fluid will be left. So what you do, tell the patient to just remove the sponge from the vagina, because it's already a dependent part due to hollow sacral curve. So immediately entire fluid, just like, that's why I gave you an example of the washing machine. That how the washing machine, you exit your fluid. Same way you will do.
If you don't have cocoa, do you feel good to
tilting the patient. Colpotomy, if you don't have, then you suck it from the cul-de-sac. Head up and suck from cul-de-sac. Suck it from cul-de-sac. And now you will see here, all the fluid has gone out. Within few seconds, it is gone out because now vagina was opened. Only from anterior cul-de-sac, little bit it will not go because it is dependent area, and posterior cul-de-sac and everything is out. After that, immediately you will repeat the same action few more time, so that you can clean, and it looks like that this patient was nothing, any pathology ever, and it is doing peritoneal. This is called peritoneal toileting, and it is one of the best thing laparoscopy can do, even in case of duodenal perforation, even in cases of rupture of the appendix. Laparoscopy can clean the abdomen much better than open surgery. Open surgery, you cannot see those debris also. We uselessly, you go with the sponge and blindly we mop it and take it out and just try to excuse it in the hot water. Again go and blindly you are doing it. But you don't have magnified view. How can in open surgery you can go near the vena cava? How can you see below the liver? How can you see the splenic area? This is the only laparoscopy which can go to the paracolic gutter and you can clean every area. So I will go a little ahead because it will continue for many times, and ultimately this is the last time, and four times you have to do. That is the meaning of copious lavage. That is three liter saline you have to use four times. And now it is coming out and then it is again exit. So this way you can do the oophorectomy. Now I will show you how to do ovarian cystectomy. Ovarian cystectomy, you have to, this is before surgery, this is after surgery. Ovarian cystectomy, your attempt should be that you should take it without rupturing. And 50% of the cases you will be able to do without rupture. How to, especially if it is up to 3 to 4, 5 centimeter, but after 5 centimeter, incidence of rupturing increases. If it is more than 10 centimeter, then impossible to take any ovarian cyst without aspirating it. Now this is a small dermoid. You can go with the harmonic and slowly you can open the outer ovarian cortex. Good thing about the ovary is that all the follicles and functional surface is outside. So even if you split it, there is no issue. And inside the ovary, if you do some dissection also, then generally the function is not hampered. So even if you leave it open, which we do always, we leave it open, there is no any chance of any abnormality. So now this is cut, and after that you can take and you can split it, the outer ovarian cortex. And then with the finger you can, just with the Maryland, you can try to dissect the layer. This is very good in the robotics. I will take the robotic lecture, and you have a hands-on during diploma for the robotic also on 17th. Then you will realize that how good it is. You have to go and you can articulate any direction. It is just like your finger. It can go any direction. But laparoscopically also you can do it. And here the open the jaw and you can go anywhere, any plane, and you can open the jaw. And you can articulate in any direction. So this is slowly. You will do it. And always try to hold the cyst with the atraumatic grasper. Maryland is not a grasper. If you hold by Maryland, it has to puncture. It is a dissector, it's not a grasper. And you should never use semi-traumatic grasper. And traumatic is not possible also. So this is the outer peritoneal layer, and now this atraumatic grasper is holding and Maryland is trying to enucleate it. And if it ruptures, never mind. It happens, it is allowed. And copious lavage only you do it. Some people, they don't believe it. And some people, they give you bad comments if you rupture. But don't worry, all the literatures are with you. None of them they criticize. And it is not your skill problem, it happens. And it's a part of surgery, now it is out. And now what you do, you don't need to close the ovary. Just you invert it and do irrigation and suction and leave it. Maximum what you can do, sometimes if edges are bleeding with the bipolar, you can touch it. The margins of the cyst, you can touch it. And now suction irrigation you will do. And here, by the way, I will show you, this is the uterine hump. Can you see that? And this is the gray area. Do you remember? This is the part where you will put morselin tape. This is the part where you will ligate the uterine artery. And this is how much where? This is 2 centimeters above the vaginal arc of uterosacral ligament, just lateral to the cervix. This is the point which is interest. This is your snapshots. You are doing any surgery, but brain will see it and smile, oh, if I would have done the hysterectomy, I must have ligated here. So in laparoscopy, whenever you do even diagnostic laparoscopy, you should keep on making you familiar. What is this external iliac vein? What is this external iliac artery? And this is external iliac vein. And here is the IP ligament. And this is the uterine artery. So this is how anatomy is clear. Now you will do the suction irrigation and dermoid is done. In this patient, we have not used any uterine manipulator. So uterus was lifted. Now this is a 5 millimeter telescope. That's why vision is diminished. And the endobag is coming with the 10 mm umbilical port. Now this is, you will put it in the 10 mm umbilical port. And after that, you will close the endobag and bring it out through the umbilicus. And once it comes out through the umbilicus, you and your assistant will open the endobag and with the ovum forceps, you should rupture the cyst inside the endobag. Without rupturing the cyst, it won't come out because it will give you transverse arrest. So you should try to rupture it through the umbilical, and here it is ruptured, and now slowly, as soon as you rupture, it will give you way. And now it comes out. It is ruptured now and it is out. And this is the fatty content and hair in the cyst. So this is how the smaller cyst can be taken out. Now there may be large cyst. So this patient is unmarried and she has that much big cyst. You can see this is umbilicus. So you cannot possible to the umbilicus. So Palmer's point will be used. And she is in supine position because you cannot use uterine manipulator. You cannot access through the vagina. So you need four port here. So there is one port here, Palmer's, one port here and one port here. This will be the one port. That will be for endobag. So in these cases, you have to put an endobag and you need to put the cyst into the endobag and then you need, it is a dermoid cyst. I don't remember, let me start. So now this is Palmer's point. Palmer's point is midclavicular line just below the comma. This is Palmer's. This is Palmer's point. But generally this we give here. This is called as Mishra's point. And what we do, we stretch it down. So you don't need to repair. So midclavicular line, you stretch the skin down. So good thing about that, after surgery, you will not have to repair the port. So this is how you can stretch it down and then give the point. So this is, if you see, this is costal margin. So basically it is 2 centimeters above the costal margin. Not here, real palmar is here. But it go on the rib after leaving it. And remember, after pneumopatonium, it moves up, so automatically it will allow the telescope to go. So this is the point, and this is the real palmar, this is costal margin, and real palmar is here. So this we do, and it is not necessary for you to do, but you can stretch it down like that. And after that, you go from palmar's here. The palmar is gone down actually. This is a modified palmar's, you can say. After that, you will just take a small stab wound, 11 number knife, and prick it in the midclavicular line. You will prick it. And then you go with the various needle, you will get click sound here, external oblique aponeurosis, internal oblique aponeurosis and peritoneum. So this is one click, this is two click, this is three click. You have to point it right towards the stomach. You should try to perforate the stomach, then you are safe. If you try to save the stomach, then you are in trouble. So this is irrigation, this is suction, and then you go with the hanging drop test. This is hanging drop, which is sucked in. That means it is fine. After that, you can attach the tubing of insufflator, and same way you will wait for quadromanometric indicator. That is preset pressure you will keep 15, actual pressure will glow slowly, total amount of gas minimum 1.5, maximum 6, and initially flow rate should be 1 liter per minute. And the pneumoperitoneum will form. After pneumoperitoneum, automatically it go above and it give you a space in between. So you can see this is 6, actual pressure is going 6, and slowly, slowly you will wait till 15, and there also it is pointed towards the stomach. And index finger should must be supported, middle finger should wrap around the air inlet, and slowly you will point rightly towards the stomach, and you are in. Once you are in, after that you can introduce the telescope, and it, here the telescope always will remain in the palmars itself, because through here only you can perform, because your target is here. Your target is, I will show you that, let it go, yes, here, your target is here, this is your target. So this is your one arc, this is your second arc, and as I told you, telescope may be 24 centimeter, isn't it, 24 centimeter, and another port, one port will be here, and one port will be at here, and one port will be here. So this is 1, 2, 3, and this is telescope, and this is your, here you will perform it, and this is 30 degree. So this is 2 ipsilateral port, which has a 30 degree, 1 contralateral 60 degree, and telescope is here. This is telescope. So this is according to basic principles of the baseball diamond concept. After that you will introduce the telescope, and here inside. So this patient has a, this is simple cyst, this is not dermoid. Dermoid is another case. So this was simple. And then this is the aspiration needle. You will puncture the aspiration needle, and then you check the color of the fluid. Color of fluid was fantastic, watery completely. So that means it is not dermoid, it's not endometrioma, it's not mucinous cystadenoma also. It is a simple cyst. And there is no uterine manipulator. So how do you do? Just enlarge the incision, because aspirating with the needle takes a lot of time. So once you are sure that content is watery, then you can enlarge the incision, and after that you can use the suction, because suction will do very fast suction. So this is harmonic, which is enlarging the incision. Initially, when you will perforate a syringe, it will let you know the type of cyst.
Yes.
If you suppose if it is a chocolate and all, then you will not puncture, you will put an endo bag from other port and drop it, endo bag inside. How to do? I will show you in next case, next video. So now it is enlarged. How to do? We will see that. And if you know already the dermoid, ultrasound and all, then you will, from beginning only, you will prepare for putting inside endo bag and then aspirate. So that is a spill, it will go in the endo bag. How to do, we will see that later. But it was confirmed by the aspiration needle, so that it is a simple cyst. And it is a watery content. As you can see, only watery content is coming. That is a simple cyst. And this is collapsing, 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 because without aspirating large cyst, we cannot handle by the laparoscopic instrument. You cannot hold also. Because once you, just like you can, if you have a very much big balloon, then it is, you need two hands to hold. And with if collapsed balloon, with the finger also you can hold. So our laparoscopic instruments are like a finger. And this is aspirated now. By the way, I will show you that here this is the one endometrioma also. This is unmarried girl with the normal nulliparous uterus. This is the triangle of doom. Here is one endometrioma also. This is common iliac, this is ureter. So this is the ureter going, this is the aorta, and here is the peristalsis of ureter. Here. Can you see that? And this is the, now it is a little bit enlarged. Little bit enlarged, you can enlarge the incision up to 3 centimeter. And after that, you can hold with the left hand, you can hold the inner cystic layer, and with the right hand, you can open the outer ovarian cortex. So this is inner cystic layer. And you have to keep on changing the hand. Sometime left will hold the cyst, right will enucleate, sometime right will hold. One very important precaution is that never apply all at once. This is the inner cyst go down, this is go up, and this is the plane. One very important trick is that don't apply all at one side. Go bilateral, all symmetrical. Then only it comes out. If you go one side more, it tears. So you need bilaterally, symmetrically to go all around. So this is the inner cystic layer is pulling and outer is separating. Inner, again you will hold it and again you will keep on pulling the outer one. This way slowly, slowly you can keep on slipping out. And here you hold and again catch it. So this is the inner cystic layer. You have to hold it and strip with the outer cortex. All around symmetrical, left has to hold, right has to strip, right has to hold, left has to strip. And some people they do hydrodissection, but I don't believe for ovarian cystectomy. We do without hydrodissection. Hydrodissection help in myomectomy. But in ovarian cystectomy, hydrodissection generally doesn't go in this proper layer and makes pseudo layer. So generally we don't believe the hydrodissection. You have to do the manually blunt dissection. Here this is the plane. You can see plane will achieve once you do little bit. Automatically a plane is achieved here. And it is going through that plane. Here is the plane. You will see immediately it will be visible. And this is the outer cortex. And here, this is the plane. And it is coming through that. Again, left will hold the, and again right will strip. And this is coming out. So this is the plane. And it's a beautiful plane, thick. Bigger cyst, that's why it is taking time, but it is coming at, can you see the plane? This is the plane, here. This is coming, again you go catch nearer and again strip the outer. It is just like hernia surgery, how you are separating the sac from pseudo sac. Same way, this is pseudo sac and this is sac. And this is your sac and this is your pseudo sac. Once you differentiate the layer between the hair, this is pseudo sac and this is true sac. True sac is your cyst and this is your ovary. And once you learn this technique of doing the pseudo sac with the sac, just like hernia surgery, you will be able to do it. The surgeon who do the hernia surgery can do the ovarian cystectomy also easily. So this is how you will hold it and you can strip it away like this. And it is stripping out. Again, left will hold and right will push. So it's not about pulling, it is about pushing. So the cyst should be held and ovary should be pushed away. And now it is going out. Again you can hold it and again you can push it away. And you have the good surgery, that means it must be taken intact. It should be taken all intact. And ambidexterity is required and it should not break in a piecemeal. If it break in the piecemeal, that means there will recurrence chances are there. It is coming out. This is semi-traumatic. This is semi-traumatic grasper. Sometime in very difficult endometrioma, even the traumatic grasper is required. Because it is already ruptured now, so there is no point of anything. So if it slips repeatedly, if you atraumatic only you should use when you don't want to rupture. But when it is already ruptured, semi-traumatic will be better hold. Because repeatedly it will slip. So now it is coming slowly. and time to time you should drop it and again try to resolve the plane, because you may sometime started separating ovary from ovary, ovary from ovary, because of lost plane. So you should take your time to get a good plane, and that's why all around at you should do symmetrical, one side not all. This is the cyst, this is the ovary, and here is the plane. No, it won't make any difference. Incision is very big. Incision doesn't make difference, because you can see the incision is good enough. By increasing the incision will not give any benefit. It is just adherence of the cyst with the... But if it is too small, then also it's not good. Then in those situations, you can see it, incision, this is outer layer. Incision is already nice. If incision is big, automatically it tears. Once you pull, automatically incision enlarges. So slowly, slowly it is coming out, and here it is, just last part is attached. This is the last part of the cyst, which is just about to give you way. This is the ovary, this is the last part of the cyst, which is coming out. So it may take hours also sometime in the large cyst, but patience is the key. You should keep on doing, keep on doing, keep on doing, and one day, one time we will reach the complete cyst on the base. Pardon? Now, you can, it depends upon circumstances. Now it is done. Here there was one more problem. By the way, it is common iliac vessel, this is sacral pulmonary. There was one more problem. This is fimbria is fine. Fimbria is fine, and this is an unmarried girl, so you cannot touch the fimbria. And there was one more problem, there was one chocolate cyst also here. You can see this cyst is, this ovary is good, but here is a chocolate material, this. Here. So what to do? You can just remove it without puncturing, because it is on outer surface. So you can just enucleate it. And for this is the ureter, by the way. This is the ureter peristalsis. Here is sacral pulmonary. This is common iliac pulsation. This is aorta. By the way, this is aorta. This is one common iliac. This is among common iliac. This vision is because you are in Palmer's. If you would have been in Amblycus, you will not see that. So because you are far away in the Palmer's. And this is ureter peristalsis. So now this is the aorta here. This is the pure aorta. Can you see that?
Yes.
This is the pulsation of aorta here. And this is sacral pulmonary. And this is the common iliac. This is vena cava below. Now this is ligature. Ligature is now better option, because it will cut all around the cyst and you can enucleate a layer without puncturing it. So it is sealing better, it will be bloodless, and this entire cyst is localized in a pocket, so you can remove it out. Of course, little ovary will be compromised, some ovary and tissue, but ovary is very good organ. Even 40% of the ovary remain, it works, because it has a lot of ovarian reserves. And you can see the ovarian tissue are stretched a lot because of the size of cyst. But once cyst is removed, then remaining ovary within 1 month it shrinks. And again it becomes almond shape. We have done a lot of ovarian, large ovarian cystectomy, and after 1 year for any other surgery like cholecystectomy and all, and you will be surprised that it looks like there was nothing there. All these big ovary, it looks like, all will shrink. So our body has a lot of capacity to remodeling. Whenever stretch will go, automatically it will remodel and it become normal shape. And you don't need to close. Closing is actually bad. When you are closing the surface of the ovary, you are inviting hematoma there to form in between. So let it open so that if any oozing is there, it will go to the peritoneal cavity, and peritoneum has a lot of macrophage, neutrophil and absorption capacity. That's why whenever there is a hemoperitoneum or there is a bleeding in the peritoneal cavity, automatically it resolves. Up to 500 ml it can absorb, but if it is more than 500, there is a chance of abscess formation because absorption delayed, and if absorption delayed, it can act as a culture medium for bacteria to grow. So that's why we should, by ourselves, we should not leave any fluid or any blood, but that much will not bleed, but always there is a potential risk of bleeding from the ovarian internal surface, 10 ml, 20 ml, 50 ml. So if you are closing it, you are making a hemorrhagic cyst. No, you have to drop it in the adhesion. Adhesion is due to this, must drop it again in the ovarian fossa and leave it. If you want adhesion prevention, some people they leave lomodexin saline or crystalloid solution. They leave it, but how much it works, nobody knows. So, and even if you suture adhesion, if it is there, it will happen. So, this is now completely enucleated. Recurrence chances of dermoid, if it is completely removed, there is no recurrence. In endometrioma, recurrence chances are same as open surgery. In simple cyst, if the wall you have not left, now this is endobag. This is an auto suture endobag. This is commercially available endobag. And this will be introduced from the 110 mm port. So this port is now enlarged to 10 mm. This is 10 mm port, and then you can go and you can drop the endobag. This is a endometrioma. This has a self-retaining metal ring. So automatically it will hold and you can scoop the hair. So this is the endometrioma. Open it and you can scoop it there. So this cyst, you can drop it into the endobag. And this endometrioma is scooping by the endobag. Automatically it will lift it because it has a metal ring. And this is the other cyst. And then drop it. And this is a metal ring which you will close it. It will close like a purse string. And then bring it into the cannula and then bring it out. After that, with the ovum forceps inside the endobag, you have to rupture the endometrioma. Ovum forceps, just like how in college cystectomy with the ovum forceps we rupture the stone. So this is, and now outside your assistant will open, and this endobag is acting as a wound protector. And by the side you will take the cyst out, right, left, zigzag fashion. You will take it out. And it is coming because it is already collapsed, and now this endometrioma also came out, and then final suction irrigation, final inspection of the cavity, and you may leave some saline. Some people they leave ringer lactate also so that it get absorbed in due course of the time and it act as a prevention. And see, now ovary is in ovarian fossa. Ovary has gone in ovarian fossa, so there will be no chances of going in contact with the omentum. And then adhesion will be less. So you should keep the ovary not outside the uterus in the normal situation. And then again irrigation suction, you can do thorough and you can shake it so that any clot, if it is there, it comes up and you can suck the fluid out. So ovarian cystectomy is a very interesting surgery, and laparoscopy is the gold standard now. And SPLS, don't worry. SPLS, if you fear, you should not do laparoscopic ovarian cystectomy, because there is no guarantee that it will not spill. It has to spill in due course, any time. So this is aspirated, and now if you want, you can leave little more fluid inside. So again, this is another surgery. In this patient, there was dermoid cyst. This patient, this is a dermoid cyst, let me check it, what is there. Oh, I don't remember, let us see. Endometrioma, I think it is. It looked like endometrioma. So this was a, yes, endometrioma and seed is ruptured. Now, as soon as endometrioma ruptures, immediately head should be up, because fluid of endometrioma should not gravitate to the diaphragm, and you should aspirate with the suction. And this is the inside fluid. Now the layer is here, your snapshot need to be seen. How I will show you. This is the inner cystic layer, this is the outer cortex. This is cyst here, this is outer cortex. This is cyst, this is outer cortex. So this is how you have to develop this snapshot. Eventually it will develop, but from the beginning if you will try to memorize the absolute anatomy, it is very useful in the laparoscopy. So cystic wall and all the content, irrigate, suck, irrigate, suck, irrigate, suck, so that sometime it blocks your suction because of thick chocolatey material. So suction irrigation, and first evacuate the cyst. Once it is ruptured, always try to evacuate the cyst first. So let me take, and now you will hold the, this is the plane, inner cystic layer and outer cortex, slowly, slowly you will separate. Here it is, this is outer cortex and this is cystic layer. In endometrioma it is more thick, it doesn't have natural, it is not a real cyst. Basically it's a wrong tissue at wrong place. So it will be thick adhematous, but it comes out. You can see there is a little oozing. If these type of oozings happen in laparoscopy, you should not try to stop it at this moment of time. It won't stop. What you do, first you take the cyst out. After that, nicely check it and then stop. Because these are oozers, these are not the frank vessels. So unnecessarily you will spend your time. So first take the cyst out and after that you can do it. So this is the cystic layer and this is the outer cortex. This is the cystic layer and this is the ovary. Try your best that it should not tear. If you tear upon, it won't come out. And if anyway, if it is teared upon, then you do the bipolar and fulgurate that area which you could not remove. Fulguration will be performed. So just sister, this is coming out slowly, slowly. And this is the cystic layer and this is the outer cortex. This is cyst. Now this is a good plane. Here is a cyst and this is a cyst, this is the ovary. Now this is coming out easily.
Sir, now we know the time of the fluid only after aspiration. Can we do some MRI or something to help
Not only MRI, even a good ultrasonologist will let you know. Even a good ultrasonologist, they can tell you it is endometrioma or dermoid or mucinous. MRI is very good. Very good. But then also, from our side, it is necessary to make it sure. We can see a lot of blood, but that blood is all the oozes. It is not a frank bleeding, so you should not spend time in stopping that blood. First you finish your work. Of course, if vision is interfering you, then you should first aspirate it. You should also be careful that sometimes fimbria is also adhered in one of the surface of the ovary. Accidentally, you should not tear the fimbria out. Unfortunately, most of the patient who has the ovarian cyst, they are in fertility age group. So this is their main concern, that ovary should not be damaged. The best way of practicing the ovarian cystectomy is that you should take two balloons and put some yogurt in the inner balloon, and that inner balloon you put on the outer balloon and tie a knot of both the balloon and put inside the endotrainer. Now your task is to strip the outer balloon without puncturing the inner one, and you have to practice it. And within few days you will get how to play with the stripping technique without damaging the outer balloon. So these type of simple exercises also help in laparoscopy to develop the skill. No, sometime we apply Fevicol in between both. We have this practical in diploma period. And no, it is not so easy, because holding the balloon is so thin. Holding is very difficult with the Maryland. Yes, and easily you can rupture. So the idea is to develop precision. Precision, your intro-CI, your lumbricals will get precision. So now it is almost out. And we can see it is reaching up to the left side. And so thick walled here. This is the other side. So one side was more. So you should stop that side and then apply on the other side. This is the plane here, this side. This is the cyst, and here this is the ovary. is just reaching in the base. It is now fine, final part. So it is out, now it is free. So you can inspect it, that there should not be any attachment remaining, it is out. After that, suction irrigation, thorough, and check the all the margins of the ovary, remaining ovary, for any bleeding. This is the remaining ovary, just lift it and do thorough suction irrigation. This is everted, just like a half cut lemon. It gets inverted. So first clean it and then invert it. All these will go. This is just like a half cut lemon. If you push it, it gets completely inverted. So it has to be inverted. This is the outer surface. And these will go back. But this is fimbria. This is fimbria. So you should suck it and then invert it in. Some people, they do marsupialization the margins. That is by running suture. It is useless spending the time. Just invert it, check for bleeding. If you want marsupialization, do by the coagulation. With the bipolar, you can touch the margins. So this is now outer surface. And good thing, these are the follicles. These are the functional part of the cyst. So entire cyst is inverted, which was during the process of enucleation, it was fully inverted out. Now this is the incision site. The margin is clear now, and now do the thorough suction irrigation and all the clot will be taken out. Then move it, shake it, so that clots will just do and take it out. So this way, even the large endometrioma, you can do it. It takes time, but try to do the best to take each and every cystic wall. If you leave it, there will be recurrence. Lead recurrence. Again suck, irrigate, again do repeatedly. And by that time now bleeding, because as we know, Ringer lactate act as a Hegman factor, that is extrinsic factor. It stops the bleeding, because as soon as these normal saline and potassium, sodium chloride and potassium rush touches there, extrinsic factor, it, platelet aggregation will be increased. So I am taking a little forward fast. Now this is suction, this is endobag. And endobag, and this is outside, you will open the endobag and you do endobag like that, so that this is umbilical port, and then with a ovum forceps, this is act as a wound protector, and then this is taking the cystic wall out. If you hold one wall, all the wall will come out. Make it sure that accidentally you don't catch the endobag itself. And now endobag will come out. So this was a supra-umbilical port. This is suction irrigation performed and it is out. Now this is a case in which this is also an unmarried girl. Here is a dermoid cyst. This is also supra-umbilical. As I told you, that any patient who has palpable cyst, you cannot go through the umbilicals. You have to go palmar or supra-umbilical. And now this is an endobag, which is already we know that it is dermoid. So bring an endobag and then you drop the ovary in the endobag, like this. And then do the job. And here this is, you can see, this is the endobag, and do the job. And people were happy. But remember, in spite of that, a spillage happened. Because once fluid will leak, why should it go endobag? It will go wherever it wants. But people will not comment, bad comment, you will not get it. And medico-legally also you can say, yes, yes, I have used endobag. So it is safe. And this is how. Do you know, I did one dermoid cystectomy in year 2003. After 1 year, patient came with a lump in the right iliac fossa. So I sent the patient for FNSE. And after FNSE, it was turned into the squamous cell carcinoma of the abdominal wall. It is an extremely rare complication. 1 in 1,100,000 it happens. Because during removal, it was touching somewhere in the abdominal wall and then there was a squamous cell carcinoma. So you may be that much unlucky that it may happen. But in spite of that, laparoscopy is allowed because in 1 in 1,000,000 is okay. So, of course, laparoscopy is risky in all the way. Even severe injury is 5 times more, ureteric injury is 4 times more. But we have to think about the patient in whom it is successful. Their quality of life is very good. Yes, it can be an open. And open also it can happen. On the incision side, it can happen. So now this is now, and slowly I am taking forward fast, and see all the dermoid is taken, and it is out, and it is in endobag. Now you rupture, it is rupture in the endobag, and then slowly you close it and bring it out. So this type of endobag, here it is on the contralateral port, this is the endobag, and this is ovum forceps rupturing the cyst in the endobag, but there this was not rupturing because it was a big hair ball. Sometime in cyst there will be a very big hair ball in dermoid that will not rupture even with the ovum forceps. In those situations you might have to enlarge the incision of rectus to take it out and then do the proper port closure, because this ball of hair is very tough. So it is not coming out, so we have enlarged it, then suction irrigation was performed and thorough lavage was done. This is repeatedly thorough lavage you will do. So here if you will see, this was a hair ball. That much big ball was there, like a table tennis ball. This is all of made up of hair, pure hair. That was creating problem. And now it is cleaned and then come out. Sometimes you have frozen pelvis, like this. In this patient, you have the ovary, all is plastered. Rectum is plastered, cyst is plastered. It is all plastered ovary. Now here you should use suction irrigation and blunt dissection. Blunt dissection, you should separate rectum from the posterior cul-de-sac, ovary from posterior cul-de-sac. This all chocolate material is sucked out. Again, irrigation, suction. Now this is fulguration. In these cases, you will not have the pure cystic wall. So this is a spatula doing fulguration of the ovary, fulguration of the inner cystic layer. Even in the normal endometrioma, if you could not take the cystic wall out, you should fulgurate it. You should fulgurate it by the spatula. And this is the fulguration coming out. And this is again other side fulguration. Other side fulguration. After that, fulguration of cul-de-sac. This is again, you have to change the machine to the fulguration mode. And this is fulguration of cul-de-sac, again fulguration. Both the ovary is lifted up and repeated irrigation, suction and fulguration is performed. Once it is, this both the ovary is lifted up by 2 graspers and you do repeated irrigation, suction and rectum is also fulgurated, cul-de-sac fulgurated, all is fulgurated and then this is interseed. And you will take interseed and spread it into the posterior cul-de-sac. It will cover the posterior wall of uterus. It will cover the anterior wall of rectum and it will cover the ovarian fossa. Interseed is a reoxygenated cellulose. It is a mechanical adhesive barrier. It has a lot of advantage and this tissue can give you freedom from the adhesion. So this is slowly you will separate it and you can put it there. So it is taking slowly and this is interseed. Remember, interseed should never cover the ovary. It should be in between ovary and ovarian fossa. Then only it will protect the ovary to re-adhere to the ovarian fossa. Some people, what they do, take a bite in the ovary by a needle and keep the suture out and they apply a knot outside the skin. After 2 days they remove it. Purpose is by the time it will keep the ovary lifted up so that it will not again re-adhere to the ovarian fossa. So interseed is very useful. In your OT always few packs of interseed should be available. It is very useful in cases of myomectomy or in cases of bad endometriosis. Reports are there that interseed prevent the recurrence of endometriosis also. So it's now over and now you can suck the excess of saline and come out. So even in the frozen pelvis, laparoscopy can be good alternative. Now some people they use by CO2 laser. We don't use CO2 laser, but some people they use by CO2 laser is more dangerous because sometimes if it fire at wrong places, it can perforate the rectum. It's a bulky instrument. So nowadays with the good energy sources, you have to always protect it by one suction irrigation and entire pelvis should be dipped with the saline. So this is the endometriotic dissection with the CO2 laser. This some centers they still use it, but it is almost obsolete. Role of CO2 is almost obsolete all over the world. So here this is a sacral promontory, this is ureter, this is triangle of doom, here is the peristalsis of ureter, and this is CO2 laser which is used for different purposes here. And this is the adhesion with the rectum, pararectal area, and CO2 laser is cutting. So if you want you can use it, but generally it is more risky than the electrosurgery. Electrosurgery is more safer than this, and especially nowadays new generation of electrosurgeries are very safe.
So how is it delivered, this CO2 laser?
CO2 laser, you have one laser beamer that you have to keep at least 5-6 centimeter away. And this is the light of laser is coming here. This is the light instrument of, and this is a suction irrigation which is supporting it. And then here this is the light. Can you see that? This is the laser which is cutting.
So
you
fire on the vessel, it will rupture?
Yes, you can rupture. And unfortunately it cannot coagulate the vessel. Again you have to run with your Maryland and then coagulate. So it is a dissector, it's not a vessel sealer. But the good thing about precision of the depth of the cutting can be controlled by wattage setting. So how much deep, 3 millimeter, 5 millimeter, how much deep cutting you want, you can control it. But actually it is good where precision, depth precision is more like cataract, like for the myopia surgery. Laser is not good for laparoscopy. But in endometrioma surgery, it is used. So this is laser dissection, which is some people they use. Now other surgery which is very common with the laparoscopy is ovarian torsion. This patient has ovarian torsion. Ovarian torsion, we have done a lot of cases in pregnant women also. If you will put in the Google pregnancy and ovarian, this is non-pregnant woman. After that I will show you in pregnancy. This was a torsion. And this patient has previous cesarean section done. After that she developed torsion. So you can see this is all torsion at the pedicle. Can you see that?
Yes.
Here. This is all torsion. So first thing what you have to do, untorsion. Traditionally untorsion is not allowed. That the necrotic material, toxic fluid goes. But many things in laparoscopy, what was a principle in open, we say not necessary. Whatever is not possible in laparoscopy, we say not necessary. And actually it was really not necessary. Like always we do anastomosis single layer. Open surgery you do the bowel anastomosis double layer, four layer also. Always we do the closure without peritonization. In laparoscopy, not necessary. In open surgery, you close the always the ovary. Laparoscopy, not necessary. Whatsoever is difficult is not necessary. And evidence-based surgery has told that really it was not necessary. Now this ovarian cyst is taken out. Ovarian cystic part I am escaping. Because already you have seen the big, big cyst. So this is a very small cyst taken out. The cyst is out. After that, what to do? Now problem is this patient ovarian ligament is normally 3 cm. This ovarian ligament was 8 cm. And that's why torsion has happened. This is the omentum which is adhered. This is the omentum here. And this adhesiolysis is performed. Now this is adhesiolysis of the omentum. It is done. And now this is the ovarian ligament. This is a very long ovarian ligament. So, what you can do? The plication of ovarian ligament. This is a beautiful surgery you can do by laparoscopy within 5 minutes. To keep on taking a continuous bite on the ovarian ligament. 1, 2, 3, 4 bite. Not on the major ovarian, only on the ovarian ligament. You keep on taking a bite, continuous suturing with the proline. Here, this is proline. You can use ethibond or silk also. Proline is also good, slippery. But you need more knots on the proline. So this is the taking a bite. I am taking it forward fast. So because time is reaching there, this is. And now bring it out and then take a Clark knot pusher, and this is past pointing with a square knot. This is the Clark knot pusher will go and it will do the past point. No, this is Bhandarkar is also able to do it, but Clark is more used. And now, because this is a proline, so take few intracorporeal suturing also, 2-3 intracorporeal, because proline has capacity to reopen. No, what you can do, you can fix with the round ligament. Many people, they fix with the round. Ovarian fossa is a posterior leaf of the broad ligament, is a false ligament. No, it will cut through. Because you can fix with the round ligament. But ovarian fossa you cannot fix. Like a undescended testis. So now you will do it and then again you come out. So these type of surgeries are also useful in cases of ovarian torsion. And now it is out. So, if it is a simple cyst, you can take directly, but always consider a potential risk of malignancy. So any cyst which is doubtful, like dermoid or endometrioma, always prefer endobag and then enucleate it inside the endobag. Because potential port site metastasis is a medico-legal complication. If the patient wants, he can sue you. If the limitations are the large, huge dermoid cannot be, because dermoid cannot be fully aspirated. And huge dermoid, you have to do laparotomy, because they have sometimes solid component like tooth and huge ball of hair, which you have to open. So every woman after puberty get the cyst. Every gynecologist feel them also, but thankfully most of the cysts are functional, which doesn't matter.